Please stand if you're ready and join us in our opening bed.
So thank you to all of those who were here on campus yesterday, part of our yard sale. We had breakfast together. We made it an hour without power. When the power went out, we continued, and we raised $1,772. So that money will be distributed to mission ministries of our church, and we're so grateful that we'll be able to use those to further God's kingdom. Coming up today after worship, we'll have a brief call church council meeting. So if you are part of the church council, hope that you will plan to stay. We'll be in the fellowship hall. And coming up this week, the Fab Women are meeting on Tuesday night. And that invitation is open to all women of the church to come for devotion, for food, and for fellowship together. There's a couple of special Sundays coming up. In the month of May, so you'll see those noted in the bulletin and some special things we're doing to honor those days together. Next Sunday, we celebrate Mother's Day and the Festival of the Christian Home. And so part of our worship service will include a visual presentation, a slideshow. And so we invite you to submit a photo of a woman who's been inspirational to you in your life, helped make you the person that you are. That might be your mother or your grandmother or some other significant woman. And we want to celebrate and honor and thank God for those women in our lives. The 21st is going to be our ABCCM Volunteer Recognition Sunday. And also it's going to be our basket auction and lunch. So after worship, you will want to stay for lunch and for the infamous basket auction. So this is a good chance, too, to invite a friend and a neighbor. And I'm looking forward to my first lunch and basket auction here at Francis Asbury. And finally, on the back, you'll see some other announcements, but also that the final Sunday in May is Pentecost Sunday. So we invite you to wear red, yellow, orange, bright colors as we worship and celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit that comes to us on Pentecost. Now I invite you to join me in our call to worship. The Lord is our refuge.
We can find peace in God's heart and love.
When troubles assail us, we call upon the Lord.
When joy is abound,
welcome this day to God's house, one of many dwellings of the Almighty One.
We thank and praise God for God's refuge and sanctuary.
Amen.
Please stand as you are able and join in singing "The Church is One Foundation."
If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good, come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious. and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy.
Jesus said, "Let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for such as these belongs the kingdom of God." So we remember those words of Jesus. We'll invite all of our young disciples to come up for a time of sharing. When you feel like that, you can know that I am with you. you can feel me in your heart, and you can pray, and you can look around at other people, like your church family, or your friends, or maybe the songs that we sing, and feel that I am with you, okay? So he said, don't be worried, friends. You're not by yourselves. All right, well, let's pray and thank Jesus for that. Dear Jesus, thank you for how much you love us. Thank you for coming to be like us, and thank you for being our friend. Sometimes, Jesus, we are a little nervous, worried, and we know you know what that feels like. You've told us that that's okay and that you are always with us. So we know, God, we're going to trust you that you are with us every day. And we love you so much. And we pray in your name. And all God's children say, amen. Amen. Thank you for coming up this morning. You can go to the children's church.
You're able to join in singing His Eyes on Sparrow.
One name, one family to that list, and that is the family of Jim Troll. Jim died last night, and so we want to lift up Nellie and their family as he has transitioned to the church triumphant. In fact, I told her last night when I spoke to her that this morning during our worship, her church family would be praying for her, and so that during this time they could feel that from their church family. So know that you will be faithful in doing so. You might have other joys and concerns on your heart and on your mind today, and so we will observe a moment of silence for you to offer those prayers, and then I will offer a prayer for us together. Let us pray. O God of love, we are so grateful for your presence that always abides with us and grants us a home with you. You have gathered us together today as one body in one spirit, and we come to worship you with all that we are. God, you are our rock. We stand upon you and no other. We pray that you will strengthen our faith, nourish us at your table, and send us out to live as your disciples. As we pray together this day, we offer prayers of compassion for all your children whose hearts are troubled, for your children who feel like they have been abandoned, your children who are dealing with physical and with mental illness, your children who give every last ounce of their own energy to fulfill their caregiving responsibilities. We pray for your children who grieve what is no more: relationships, abilities, opportunities, jobs, and the physical presence of loved ones. We lift up your children whose hearts are troubled by the power of addiction, your children who have been made to feel as though they are less than, and all of your children who are longing for hope. Lord, to all of these, grant your peace, your comfort, your presence. We pray together for the community in which we live and work and learn. We pray together for our church, that you will guide and equip us as we live out our mission of praising you, growing spiritually, and reaching our neighbors. We pray for our country and for its leaders, and for leaders throughout the world. We pray for your church, O God, which you have called and equipped to carry out your mission in the world. Finally, God, please offer each of us today at least one clear opportunity to be of service to someone who is in need or someone whose heart is troubled. In our words and deeds, may we be a reflection of your peace and your mercy. We pray in the name of Jesus, who is our rock and our risen Lord, and we join our voices together in the prayer he has taught us, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
So we continue in worship this morning. One of our acts of worship, our spiritual acts, is to give our gifts, our tithes and offerings, which is returning to God a portion of what God has first gifted and trusted to us. We thank you for the ways that you give in response faithfully and generously, in the way that these gifts nurture and sustain and support the mission and ministry of Francis Asbury United Methodist Church, ministries of music and worship, discipleship, ministries that raise up a new generation of young disciples and flow outside of us into our community. We'll give our gifts this morning by passing offering plates down the pews, and we can always give our gifts at the physical box that is in the narthex at the back of the sanctuary, and online through our church website. We'll invite the ushers to come forward.
Thank you.
us singing our doxology?
Jesus said to him, I am the way,
in the truth, in the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, have I been with you all this time, Philip, and still you do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and, in fact, will do greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
When should I start worrying? That's the question I used to ask my parents when they were leaving and I was home alone. When should I start worrying, Mom and Dad? I wanted to know exactly what time I could expect them to return home and exactly how far outside of those parameters it was acceptable to wait before I started worrying that something might have happened. I was such a firstborn. So while my parents were out and I was home alone, or my sister and I were home alone, I knew all the important things. I knew don't open the door to strangers. I knew don't let the house catch on fire. I knew where the important phone numbers were. This was before cell phones. And I knew how to reassure my sister if I needed to. But I also realized there was a lot at stake if my parents didn't come back home. So I wanted to know, when should I start worrying? As we read John's gospel, it sounds a little bit like the disciples might have been worried about being left alone without Jesus. This passage that we've heard, this is on Thursday night, the night that we now call Maundy Thursday. For 3 weeks this month, the lectionary gives us gospel readings from this section of John's gospel, which we call Jesus' farewell discourse. It's his goodbye before his arrest and his death. And it's one of those sacred times where dear friends and loved ones spend time together and they say the things that need to be said before a departure, before a separation, and before a death. In his farewell discourse, Jesus prays for his disciples. He makes them promises. He reminds them of all the important things that he has taught them. Things like love one another. Don't be afraid. Believe in God and believe also in me. Where I'm going, you cannot follow me right now, but I will not leave you orphaned. Don't worry. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare that place, I will come again and take you with me so you can be where I am too. In John 14, Jesus is still telling those disciples the things they need to know. And they have some questions. Where exactly is he going, they wonder. One writer answers that question. He is going to die, as a matter of fact. Only that's not how he tells it. The way he tells it, he's headed off to a family reunion with his father that no one else is invited to. And he's leaving them in charge while he's gone. He will be back, but meanwhile his list is so long that it raises some anxiety in them about how long he'll be away. And they ask the kind of questions that children might ask their parents when they're left home alone. Where are you going? How long will you be gone? Can we go too? It's not a far cry from when should we start working, Jesus? And while Jesus may not give the specific answers that they have asked for, what Jesus does is he reassures them. He can hear the concern and the curiosity in their voice. He can hear their worry and even the grief that's manifesting itself already. Do not let your hearts be troubled, friends. Do not let your hearts be troubled. I can just hear Jesus saying that with this tone of calm and comfort that just seeps in to your heart and your soul. There were troubled hearts in that room when Jesus said that. Maybe even Jesus' own heart. There are troubled hearts in this room, too. We have a great deal that weighs on our minds and on our hearts. We have things that we're worried about and people that we're worried about. We're worried about our kids and our grandkids. We're worried about our parents and our spouses. We're worried about health and resources and relationships. We're concerned about the state of the world. And if for a little while we're tempted to just forget that and to be carefree, all we need to do is pick up our phone and read the notifications or cut on the news, and we see reports of conflict and violence and strife. In this season, our hearts are troubled over our United Methodist denomination as it experiences disagreement and discord and divorce. Yesterday, I attended a called annual conference meeting, as did Pam Moser, our lay delegate representative from our church. This was a meeting of our Western North Carolina annual conference where we considered the request by some of our churches to disaffiliate from the United Methodist Church. And the churches that made this request totaled about 15%. Of our annual conference, and we won't hear the results of that vote until later this week. But attending that meeting and voting, they were more difficult than I had anticipated. And that's not just because the power was out and I had to sit in front of the computer in the dark with a hotspot. It was emotionally heavy thing to do. Our hearts are troubled as we wonder about the future, and our neighbors are asking us questions with interest and with curiosity. And we're asking questions. Well, what about our church? And what about our faithful path forward? Right now, we find ourselves in a state of limbo. We're in a in-between and a waiting state. The next general conference isn't going to take place for a year, until May of 2024. So we can't say yet what, if any, decisions or changes might take place a year from now. So we wait and we see. And in the meantime, we continue to be the church. The gospel isn't changing. The mission isn't changing. And we are called to be disciples of Jesus Christ right here in our community. Next month, we'll offer a church gathering for anybody who wants to come, and I'll share information and updates and background on where we are and what's happened within our denomination so that we're up to date on where we are. To all of us, Jesus says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe, keep the faith, remember in whom you have hope. Late last night, our bishop sent out a letter to church leaders, and in the letter, he invites all of us to recommit ourselves to the teachings of Jesus, our Savior, our healer, our teacher, our Lord, and our friend. The bishop says we can continue to be a church for others, God using us as the instruments by which the Spirit is poured out on all flesh. In this, there is strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. We look around and we see God is at work in and through this church, Francis Asbury. We see that and we celebrate that and we name it and we give witness to it. Just today, on May the 7th, we get together for worship and to come to the table and celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. We get the joy of welcoming new members into our church family. After worship, our church council will meet, and they'll have the opportunity to affirm a candidate for lay speaker who has felt this call in her life. We'll also have a chance to hear about opportunities to extend the outreach of our church by partnering with others to reach and to serve neighbors. That's at the core of who we are as a church. That is God present and working in and through us and inviting us into God's kingdom. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Those are important words. And they're not just words for the 12 that are gathered around the table with Jesus. On Maundy Thursday, they're words for all disciples. Do not let your hearts be troubled. I think most often we hear them, or we hear that passage from John's Gospel read at funerals or memorial services, probably because they're so comforting and peace-filled. But those words are also appropriate and comforting in all times and in all places. Just 24 hours after Jesus utters those words, his disciples find themselves scattered and scared, and their hearts aren't just troubled, but they're breaking. And they will learn again and again not to let their hearts be troubled. They will learn again and again that they are not in Asuchi, Japan, which is a town about 300 miles outside of Tokyo, there's a garden on a hill. And under the branches of a cherry tree in that garden, there sits a white and glass-paned phone booth. And inside the phone book, there's a notebook, and there's a rotary phone. And the phone has, remember what a rotary phone is, right? Yeah. It's been a while since we've used one. But that phone has one phone, and it's neatly coiled, but it's not connected anywhere. In this phone booth, calls don't come in, they only go out. The phone booth was built by a man named Itaru Sasaki in 2011 after his cousin died from cancer. And he created this phone booth as an opportunity to process his grief and to pick up the phone and have a conversation and say what he might say to his cousin. He found that it helped him feel connected, less lonely. He said, because my thoughts couldn't be relayed over a regular phone line, I wanted them to be carried on the wind. And so over the years, that phone has come to be called the wind phone. And it's not connected to any religion. It's a pilgrimage of sorts and a spiritual experience for people. But it turns out that just a few months after he created his wind phone, and a tsunami and an earthquake hit Japan. And so his village was hit, and much of it was destroyed. Lives were lost. And this wind phone became significant. Local residents and travelers from all over Japan have started coming to this place to let their thoughts and their love and their grief be carried on the wind. It's interesting that in the New Testament, the word that's used for spirit means wind or breath. And that's what I thought of when I heard that story. Later in that same farewell discourse, Jesus promises his disciples, I won't leave you alone. The Message translation says, I don't leave you the way you're used to being left, feeling abandoned. You will still feel my presence even when I'm not physically with you because of the Holy Spirit. Wind. Breath. The one that is the advocate, the comforter, will be connected together. You'll be connected to each other by the Holy Spirit. In 3 weeks, we will celebrate Pentecost, the day that the Holy Spirit descended upon the disciples and others in Jerusalem, and it came like a mighty rushing wind and like tongues of fire. And it came with understanding and faith and ability. I think as they were gathered in the upper room that night, the disciples, they couldn't fathom what would happen in the next 53 days from Maundy Thursday all the way to Pentecost. But they heard Jesus when he said to them, I'll be with you. You have a home with me. And you will continue my ministry. In fact, friends, you're going to do even greater things. And when you ask me for support and for comfort and for peace, I will give it to you. You're going to be my disciples, my representatives in the world, and the world will know by the way that you care for others that you know me. Especially by the way you care for people whose hearts are troubled. There's a pastor in New York City who tells a story about Emmett. And Emmett was a street person, which is a way of saying he was chronically homeless in New York City. And if you happen to meet Emmett on the streets of New York, he would immediately greet you and tell you the story of his life. When the weather started to turn cold that year, Emmett would show up at the same church on a regular basis. And one night it was bitterly cold outside, and the minister told him that he could sleep inside on a pew in the narthex and be protected from the elements. And later that night, as the minister was walking around the church and cutting out the lights and closing up for the night, he could hear Emmett laying on the pew, and he was reciting that same life story that he had told so many people. And at the end, Emmett paused and he took a deep breath and he said, "Thank you, Jesus, for this warm house. It's so cold outside." That pastor says that for the winter, it seemed to that congregation like God had come to be at home with them in the person of Emmett, who was with them regularly. She said it's not that the church was just particularly righteous, it's just that Emmett being present with them taught them something about God. And so there was one Sunday the youth group was at church, or one Saturday, because they were baking the bread that was going to be used in communion the next day. When they finished their baking and everything was ready for Sunday morning worship, they got ready to leave and go home. But they realized they had left all their jackets on this pew in the narthex. But it happened to be Emmett's regular spot. And he was sound asleep on top of their piles of jackets. Well, no one got upset or reached for their jacket or disturbed him in any way. Instead, they decided, well, Emmett might be hungry when he wakes up. We should probably fix him something to eat. And so they went back to the kitchen and they found cheese and crackers and apples, and they fixed a plate and they served Emmett lunch. And when he ate the lunch, he thanked them, and then he began to tell them his life story. And later that day, the youth went home and their parents asked, "Well, what did you learn today, church? What did you learn about communion?" And what they talked about was lunch with Emmett, which really isn't a bad way to think about Holy Communion. God makes a home with us around the table, in breaking bread, sharing together. God comes and makes a home with us and changes our hearts and teaches us how to love. God offers us comfort and helps us to share that comfort with others. Last Sunday in our worship, we celebrated a hymn singing. So we named and we sang some of our favorite hymns, although we probably could have stayed here until 2 o'clock because there's so many treasures in our hymnal that we wanted to make requests and sing. But one of my favorite hymns is number 700. It's called "Abide With Me," and it's a more subdued and prayerful hymn than maybe some of the others that we sang together last week. And I think that the poet who wrote it intended for it to be a prayer. His name is Henry Francis Light. He was a Scottish poet. And supposedly he wrote the verses as he was sitting with a dear friend who was in a time of transition between this life and the one that is to come. But the fourth verse that he wrote says, "I fear no foe with thee at hand to bless. Ills have no weight, and tears no bitterness. Where is death's sting? Where grave thy victory? I triumph still if thou abide with me." Today, we're invited to gather at the table together. And we're invited by the one who is the host, the one who promises to abide with us, the one who has gone before us, the one who makes a home with us, and the one who offers us comfort whenever our hearts are troubled. Thanks be to God for that. Amen. lift up your hearts and give thanks to God. Blessed are you, O God, who with the Word and the Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your Word became flesh and dwelt among us. You took upon yourself our sin and death, and you destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead the same Jesus, who now reigns with you in glory, and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took a loaf of bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took a cup. He gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We ask, God, that you pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us who are gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of the bread and the drinking of the cup, we might know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until he comes in final victory and we feast together at his heavenly banquet table. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. This table is the table of our host. It's not our table, but all are invited to come and receive the gift of the bread and the cup. Now the ushers, when it's time, they will guide you forward to the front where you'll be served a piece of bread and a cup that is pre-filled with juice. Then we'll go to the sides where you're welcome to kneel at the altar rails to discard of your plastic cups in the trash can. And then there are baskets there we can receive our communion offerings, which go to the Givens Estates Resident Assistance Fund today. If you prefer to remain where you are and to receive the prepackaged elements, the ushers have those ready for you. So just let them know that that's what you would like to do, and you may receive the communion elements right where you are seated. And the grace is exactly the same. We'll invite those who are serving to come forward.
Thank you.
Please stand as you're able and join us in Fill My Cup, Lord.
Goes before us in every way. Amen. And go in peace. Amen.